Amen, amen. Every time I hear Lucas and Sophia play, I think they get better every time. This morning, I have the honor and the privilege to introduce to you our speaker this morning. Her name is Christina Lopez. She is no stranger to our church. She's currently a senior at FSW Collegiate High School, and some of the things that she loves to do, she likes to read and draw and spend time with her family. Christina serves our church as the SOS Youth Leader, which is a monthly event that we have for our young people that we're wanting to get started up again. And she also volunteers to serve our adventurer program. Something that I love about Christina is that before, when I was about her age, which I'm not that far from her age, to be quite honest, sometimes I'm like, oh yeah, when I was in high school, but I'm like, wait, that wasn't that long ago. I used to think that the more questions that I have, the weaker my faith would become. But I began to learn that faith is not to be walked by sight, but faith is to be walked in the midst of chaos and in the midst of ambiguity. And a lot of times I would think that if I were to wrestle with my questions, I'd be making God angry. But the older I got, I realized that as I have these questions, it is actually more faithful to be able to wrestle with the chaos and to wrestle with the darkness of my life, because in that darkness I find the light. And Christina, at her young age, is someone who's unafraid to wrestle with questions. And honestly, I've seen something in Christina that I know that is bound to grow into this beautiful, dedicated follower of Jesus. And so as you hear what God has spoken to Christina this morning, you're going to hear a woman that has really wrestled with the craziness of life, but someone who knows the tenderness of her father's heart. So friends, please join me as we welcome Christina Lopez to speak to us today.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. My name is Christina Lopez, and I am so grateful to be here to share the message with you today. But before we start, let's have a word of prayer. Okay. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us be here together on your beautiful Sabbath. Lord, when I share this message, Lord, let it just be you speaking, Lord, and let me say what you need me to say. And just help us open our hearts to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, so my question is, how many of us here have siblings? Raise your hand if you have siblings. Oh, okay, good. Most of us have siblings. Okay, so maybe you'll be able to relate to what I'm about to say, because siblings can be amazing, right? They're great. But we have to understand that sometimes they can be really annoying, right? And when you have siblings, you fight a lot. And I don't know about you guys, but me personally, growing up, I fought a lot with my sister Isabella. And not just like ordinary, like we would go WWE on each other sometimes. Like it got bad. And that's why we have parents, because we would always get caught. And that's the funny thing about parents, is that when you get in trouble, they make you make up. They force you to say, I'm sorry. But the thing is, I would never feel sorry. Like, they would pull us up here together, and she would say, now I need you to say sorry to your sister. And I'm crying, and there's like snot all over my face, and I would go like, I'm sorry. And then, like, to make things worse, they would say, no, say it like you mean it. And so then you have to let, and so then, like, I would have to fake it, and I would say, I'm sorry, right? So I always found that interesting, because when parents would force us to apologize, because if your parent has to force you to apologize, then I don't think you really mean it, right? And I always thought that defeated the whole purpose of apologizing, because if it didn't come from somewhere in here, then it doesn't really mean anything. And that is kind of what Jesus was dealing with what he saw in his people when he was on the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew. But before we get into that, it's important to understand the structure of the book of Matthew, okay? So Jesus was aiming this message towards his disciples, people who already knew the Torah. Now, why is this important? Because before Jesus came along, all that the Jewish people knew of was the Old Testament, was the Torah. And an important figure to them was Moses. And so when Jesus is on this mount, you're going to see this similarity, this parallel between Moses and Jesus, because Moses is the person who guided the Jewish people out of slavery from Egypt, and he is the one who received the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai from God himself. So when Jesus is on this mountain telling his teachings to his people, they're going to make this connection between, oh man, Moses on Mount Sinai to Jesus on this mountain. So they're going to pay attention to what he's saying, because what he's saying is very important. Okay, so let us open our books up to Matthew chapter 5 through 7. And so remember, these people are excited for what Jesus has to say, okay? They've been pumped up. They're like, oh man, Jesus is going to say something important because of all these connections, right? So it's surprising that when we read what he says, Jesus does not really introduce anything new. So why would Jesus go through all this trouble from like getting all their attention, making all these parallels, and then just tell them something that they already know? Well, let's just see what it says. Let's read Matthew 5:21. And pay attention to the highlighted portion, okay? You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of judgment. Okay. Now for the next part. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Okay. Again, he says, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, and do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. All right, so he starts off with saying things that they already know. They know the Ten Commandments, they know all the laws, right? Like, duh, don't kill people. But he doesn't just stop there, because he says, you have heard, but then he adds something else. He says, but I say to you. He doesn't just leave the laws how they are. He expands and tells them the spirit of how they need to be done. Okay? And then we'll see that he continues this in chapter 6. He goes on to tell more commandments that are not being followed correctly, okay? And I'm not going to read all of it, but just the highlighted portions. Because when he's talking about, let's say, doing charitable deeds, he says, do not sound the trumpet before you as the hypocrites do. Do your charitable deeds in secret. And then when he's referencing prayer, he says, do not be like the hypocrites, because they love to be seen by men, but pray to your Father who is in the secret place. Okay, so we just unloaded a lot of scripture here. And he keeps on mentioning these hypocrite fellows, okay? But what Jesus is saying is, like, he's saying, I know you know these laws, but you're not doing them from a place in here. You're doing it for outward attention. And when like things like generosity, prayer, fasting, when all of that comes from a place of selfishness, then it kind of defeats the whole purpose. So Jesus is saying all these things. He's expanding on all these laws and telling them to trust to trust in the Father and not themselves, because he saw that they were really missing the point in what they were doing. They were following the law, but they were missing a transformation of the heart. They were taking practices that God gave them to strengthen their relationship with God, and they were making it about themselves. It became a way of boosting themselves up, a way of comfort and control, because they were obsessing over the external, but Jesus was really focused on what was happening in here, in the internal. So he's giving them these instructions to live by. And if you pay close attention, with everything we just read, all these verses, Jesus is really just listing out who he is. He's listing out his characteristics. And so it really dawned on me that Jesus is saying, if you're really serious about following me, you really have to be me. You have to become me. Okay, and that is a little problematic. Because I'm sure, as you know, we can never be Jesus. We will always fall short. So why would Jesus say that, knowing that we really can't fulfill it? Well, let's go towards the conclusion on the Sermon on the Mount, okay? But before we start reading the conclusion, it's important to note that the endings of things are usually very important, like the ending of a movie or the ending of a book, because that's what the people are going to go home remembering. I'm not sure if any of you have ever been to like a magic show or like seen a magician do his tricks, and he does some cool stuff like pulling bunnies out of hats or, you know, doves. But then what do they always say towards the end? They say something like, and for my final act, I'm going to... And then they do something like saw a woman in half or like have fire shoot from their eyes or something crazy like that. And it's always something spectacular. So with that in mind, let's see what Jesus ends with. And it's a lot of text. So if you can open up your Bibles to Matthew 7, 24, 28. Let's read it straight through. Okay? Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house. And it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Okay. That was a lot, okay? And I'm not going to lie to you. When I first read that, I was confused and frustrated because, like, Jesus just laid this load on us, right? And then his conclusion is a riddle. Like, I said, God, why are you always talking in riddles? Like, I didn't understand that. And so it's a lot, but we're going to break it down, okay? Starting with the first portion. Starting with whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them. So this is very important. It's very important, okay? Notice how he didn't just say, whoever hears these sayings of mine, and just end it there. He said, whoever hears these sayings and does them. Because it's scary to know that, like, we can show up to church, you know? We can even just read the Bible, but Jesus, that's not enough. He says we need to hear and do. And this is also confusing as well, because his people not doing that, they knew the law. They were following the law. And he just rejected them. He just called them hypocrites. So what is he getting at? But the thing is, Jesus wasn't asking for self-centered religiosity. He wants more than that. He knows that the people on that mount could not really do what he just said. So he needed them to be transformed. And that's the scary thing about Jesus, is because he will not settle for anything less than your whole heart. He is saying to surrender your heart to him so that through him you can do all these things. Because we can be like the hypocrites and Pharisees, right? Like, we can donate all our tithes and offerings. We can, you know, go to all these programs and participate in Pathfinders and Sabbath school, and we can fast for weeks on end just drinking water. But unless we have been internally transformed by Christ, we have not really done what he has asked. Okay? So that wasn't too bad. Let's go to the next line where it talks about the two houses. And so it's a lot of words, but let's just look at the highlighted parts. Let's look at the similarities between the two houses, okay? What happened to both houses? Exactly. The rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house. And then for the second house, it says the same thing. The rains descended, the floods came and the winds blew and it beat on that house. So I'm confused. Like, what does that mean? What Jesus is saying is, this is something that is also a little scary as well, is that it does not matter if you're a Christian or an atheist or a Buddhist or a Hindu. Like, hard times are going to happen to all of us. Just because you have a strong foundation, it does not exempt you from the tragedies and temptations of this earth. This really puts everyone on level ground. Okay? So now that we have gone through the similarities, let's look at the differences here. Let's start with the first house. So we know what happened to the first house, okay? The wind came, the rain came, but it did not fall. Why? Because it was founded on the rock. You see, the difference between the two houses was that this first house knew that it cannot do what Jesus was asking without him. That house, in desperation, cries out for Jesus Christ, okay? That first house surrenders their whole hearts and lets Jesus in so that they can be one with Jesus. Because through Jesus, they can handle those storms. Because you'll find that that first house has realized that when the hard times do come, when the wind comes and is beating on that house, they'll realize that it's not the wind that's beating on them, it's the wind that's beating on Jesus. Okay? And so that's why they were able to stand, because their foundation was in Jesus. So this leads us to the second house. Oh, the second house. Okay. So the same thing happens to the second house, right? The rain, the wind, the pushing. But what happened to the second house? Because it was founded on sand, it fell. And Jesus doesn't just say it fell. He says, and great was its fall. I'm sure that Jesus on that mount saw his people there. And he saw that he saw their vain obsessions. He saw how they were trying to do the law, but they weren't doing it with the Spirit. And he knew that they were building their faith on sand. He knew that that was not going to be enough. It was not going to be enough, because when those rains came, their house was going to fall. Because they thought that they alone could handle that storm that was approaching, but he knew they couldn't. He knew they needed him. So he's telling them here straight up, what you're doing right now is not going to be enough for when that rain comes. And you're not just going to fall, you're going to be destroyed. And you know, I say this, and this passage really speaks to me, because I really do know what it's like to be, I know what it's like to be part of the second house. You see, I was raised a Christian, I was raised Adventist, and I went to church and I, you know, listened to the sermons and I sang and I did Pathfinders and I even opened up my Bible and read it. But there was something not right. Something inside, like, wasn't clicking. And so I would ask God, like, God, why? Like, what am I doing wrong, God? I'm doing all these things. I'm doing all these things, and yet I'm still suffering. Why is it that I still have all these questions, Lord? Why am I still doubting you? Why am I still so full of doubt, Lord? Why am I still struggling with the same old temptations? And I'm asking God, what else can I do? Because I've given you everything. But my problem was that I was telling God, what can I do? I was living my life as if Jesus was still deciding that if he was going to die for me or not. But there really is nothing I could do. No matter what I did, no matter what I'm doing now, no matter what I will do, that's not going to change Jesus' love for me. And so, yes, alone I can't do it, but with Jesus I can. And so, it's really not about what I can do, but it's what Jesus has already done for me and for all of us. Because Jesus saw all of our sin and he still chose us. So, anything less than a total transformation of the heart through Christ will not be enough to sustain us. Okay? Because the winds of the world will come crashing down, but those sermons won't save us. Those songs alone won't save us. Participating in all these programs and activities is not going to be the thing that saves us, because all the emotions, the highs and the lows that we feel in the moment, they're not going to save us. Because anything that comes from ourselves, that comes from the self, is not going to be enough. And so it is only through a personal encounter with Christ that he is able to transform us. Because Jesus is enough. And once that happens, once we're able to allow ourselves, once we open our hearts to Christ and allow him to transform us, I guarantee you that you will not be the same. I promise you, you won't be the same. And the world won't understand that. But those winds are going to blow, and that rain is going to come, but you will have Jesus, and that will be enough. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord. Lord, thank you for being enough for us, Lord, because you know that we can never do it by ourselves. Lord, please let us open our hearts, and let's not focus on what we can do, because there really is nothing that we can do. And Lord, please just let us let you in, so that through you we can be strong and handle the winds of this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.